This team of American scientists has uncovered the remains of 2-million-year-old ground sloths. Today, I'm joining the dig because it was fossils like these that made a huge impression on the young Charles Darwin during his voyage on HMS Beagle. To Darwin, they looked like ancient giant versions of animals he saw around him.
Well, the ground sloths flourished for a number of millions of years and were quite successful.
They were huge, weren't they?
Some of them were. They varied from bear-sized all the way up to things that were almost rivaling the mammoths and mastodons, up to 5 to 6 meters in height when they reared up on their hind legs.
What struck Darwin was how, apart from their enormous size, the fossils closely resembled in every other detail the skeletons of modern sloths living nearby.
You can definitely see similarities in their details of their teeth, peculiar features that they share with modern armadillos, modern tree sloths, and actually modern anteaters. You know, we can infer that they are related to these animals.
The discovery of fossils was a huge challenge to the religious orthodoxy of Darwin's youth. What were these animals? When had they lived? And why didn't they exist anymore? Some suggested that fossils were just God playfully ornamenting his world. Others claimed they were the bones of sinners drowned in Noah's flood. But Darwin was one of the first scientists to correctly identify them as long-dead species of animals. He was starting to grasp that the Earth might be a lot older than the Bible led us to believe. And how had he realized this? Through a fascination with geology. During the voyage of the Beagle, Darwin had had time to immerse himself in the pioneering work of Charles Lyell. Lyell argued that the landscape we saw around us was formed by the slow action of vast forces, not thousands, but millions of years of gradual change. So, if the Earth was shaped and reshaped over an immense period of time, was there room, Darwin began to wonder, for life to undergo slow changes as well?
You know how old these rocks are? They're about 200 million years old. Right back in the 19th century, lots and lots of people came here to look for fossils. And some of the most famous fossils have been found here.
I'm taking the science class I met earlier to the beach. Many of these teenagers have been brought up to mistrust the idea of evolution. I'm hoping they'll find a small fragment of the kind of evidence that made Charles Darwin think again. You know what our ancestors were like 200 million years ago?
Because so
they were around. I mean, they wouldn't have been here because this would have been the bottom of the sea. They would have been kind of like shrews, sort of little whiskery, twitchy.
It seems to be like a dream, but it's real.
Yeah. Yes, it does, doesn't it? This is all sedimentary rock, meaning it's laid down at the bottom of the sea, mud coming down layer after layer after layer. That's what the fossils are actually in.
On a beach like this, the pounding sea gradually exposes different layers of rock, and within them, hidden treasure, a history of past life on Earth.
So each layer you go down to, you find a completely different set of animals. And if you look at the animals that you find, and plants, over the great span of time, you find that they form a kind of ordered sequence. You find fish 400 million years ago, but you find no mammals at all 400 million years ago. The fish gradually changed into amphibians, changed into reptiles. Reptiles changed into birds, changed into mammals. Did you find that?
Yeah.
Oh, that's terrific. That's really great. Yeah. That's a beautiful ammonite. That's really beautiful. Well done for finding that. That's wonderful.
The fossil hunt has been a success. Like Darwin, these teenagers have been brought face to face with some tangible remnants of evolution.
The evidence Darwin had seen with his own eyes on the voyage of the Beagle seeded huge heretical questions in his mind. And once he started thinking, he couldn't stop. Darwin, once an easily distracted student, returned from the voyage of the Beagle a determined, even obsessive research scientist. The trip had changed him, and it was soon to change the world forever.
Back in London in the late 1830s, the specimens he'd collected and his reporting of the voyage made Darwin a scientific celebrity. Even more importantly, while cataloguing his finds, Darwin realized that life forms weren't fixed. They had changed over time. They must have evolved. Now he wanted to pull together all the evidence to understand how and why this had happened. It took Darwin 20 years of research, on and off, to develop the ideas that would eventually be set out in The Origin of Species. He wanted to be fully certain of his facts. The hard graft was done here at Darwin's home, Down House in Kent.
Long before the days of the internet, of course, Darwin drew upon the collective knowledge of an entire generation of naturalists all over the world.
He sent out thousands of letters asking for data, posing questions, trying out theories.
And back the letters flowed from all around the world into Down House, a river of information.
Darwin studied the detail of how different mammals share remarkably similar skeletons. Their limbs have the same bones in the same order, just reshaped and resized to suit different ways of life. He was drawn to the similarity of early embryo development in very different types of animals, fish, birds, reptiles. Increasingly, he became convinced that every living thing must be related to every other. Darwin began to see the history of life as a vast family tree. Life began millions of years ago at the base of the tree, and as time went by, our ancestors evolved, split off and multiplied along branches, until now every species on the planet is a twig at the end of a branch. All are related, all cousins. Life had evolved from single cells into complex, sophisticated beings. It may seem like a huge leap, but Darwin realized it had been achieved by small steps over a vast span of time. He grasped the immense age of the Earth. Darwin believed the world was hundreds of millions of years old. Today we know it's over 4 billion years old. And the life we can actually see around us has existed for an insignificant blink of that time.
Darwin's wife, Emma, used to play to him on the piano in this very room, and Darwin would lie on the sofa and listen. It's not clear how much he got out of it, though, because it was once said of him that he was so tone deaf that people had to nudge him to stand up when they were playing God Save the Queen. But anyway, I want to use this piano to illustrate the vastness of geological time and yet how comparatively little of it is occupied by those animals and plants that we know anything about. If we have the origin of life at the bottom of the piano there and recent times at the top, I find it astonishing that we have nothing but bacteria all the way up here, past middle C, way up to about here, when more complicated cells than bacteria first evolve. And then we get the first many-celled animals, the first large animals somewhere here. Fish start around here. The dinosaurs don't come in until about here. And then the extinction of the dinosaurs around here. About here, the apes and monkeys. And the whole of human history would occupy a space less than the width of one piano string right at the top of the keyboard.